Welcome back to All About That Disney Life. I am Danny B, the girl who is all about that Disney life. We now move on to our next attraction for Epcot. It is Test Track, which is located in the World Discovery section of the park. So here's a little bit of backstory to this amazing ride. This is a high-speed slot car thrill ride manufactured by Dynamic Attractions. The ride is a simulated excursion through the rigorous testing procedures that General Motors uses to evaluate its concept cars, culminating in a high-speed drive around the exterior of the attraction. So a little bit of history to this ride. Test Track was not always Test Track. It actually replaced World of Motion. So let's start off by talking about the original Test Track, which was presented by General Motors, known as Test Track 1.0. World of Motion was an attraction that was located in the current building of Test Track and was sponsored by General Motors. When the sponsorship expired, GM was in the process of conducting layoffs and cutbacks, forcing the company to question whether or not to sign another sponsorship agreement. Upon deciding to sign another agreement, GM wanted Disney to construct a new ride on the site of World of Motion. The new ride would focus specifically on their automobiles rather than the fanciful history of transportation from the prehistoric to the modern age that were previously housed in the space. In 1976, Disney Imagineers had visited GM's Milford Proving Grounds. The Imagineers later made a second trip to the facility as they designed Test Track. After numerous problems encountered during the construction of the ride, Test Track soft opened on December 19, 1998, but did not officially open until March 17, 1999, nearly 2 years after than planned. So here's what happened in regards to the problems and why this ride was delayed for 2 years for its grand opening. In November of 1995, Epcot announced that World of Motion would be transformed into Test Track. After the attraction closed on January 2, 1996, everything inside the ride building was removed. Meanwhile, the elevated track was already being constructed outside and behind the building, part of the high-speed test portion of the ride. Work outside the building began in the fall of 1995, while work inside the building began in the spring of 1996. The ride was scheduled to open 29 months after World of Motion's closing in May of 1997. But after numerous problems arose, the ride opening was delayed by nearly 2 years. The cars used on the ride were designed to resemble the look of a test car that is used to go through multiple safety tests. Throughout the construction of Test Track, numerous problems occurred causing delays in the ride opening. After failing to open as scheduled in May of 1997, park officials announced on October 15, 1997, that the opening was delayed until at least sometime in 1998. The first problem that Imagineers had to overcome was that the wheels used on the ride vehicles could not stand up to the demand of the ride course and speed. This problem was resolved, but a second, more critical issue caused the ride to be delayed by over a year. For Test Track to run with the highest hourly capacity possible, 29 ride vehicles would be needed. The ride's programming system could only handle operating a maximum of 6 cars over the layout of the ride, and the system suffered frequent software crashes. The original software was scrapped, and eventually programmers were able to get the computer system able to run 29 ride vehicles at once. Despite some rumors about rain affecting the outdoor segment, park officials assured the weather issues were not the factor in the delay. In August of 1998, Disney announced that the opening of Test Track would be delayed once again. Officials told park guests that the technology was new and still being developed. Reports planned to reschedule the opening for 1999. After the problems were resolved, Test Track soft opened to the public on December 19, 1998. The ride was still prone to breakdowns and did not officially open until March 17, 1999. Even after its grand opening, the ride still suffered from frequent downtime, although efficiency gradually improved. Shortly after its opening to improve capacity, Test Track was one of the first rides at the Disney parks to employ a dedicated single-rider lane. The 6-seated cars were often left with empty seats, as most riders arrived in groups of 2 or 4. The single-rider line helped each car leave full and reduce long lines. In November of 1999, Epcot added a Fast Pass entrance to Test Track. So we'll talk about the original queue for Test Track 1.0. During the first part of the queue, guests viewed a sample repair and test shop. As guests entered the queue in the Welcome Center, they were shown tests performed on cars and parts before being released. The queue wound by different tests for tires and car doors, an anechoic chamber for radio receivers, and an area for crash test dummies to be tested. At the end of the queue, a group of guests would be brought into a briefing room where they were shown automobile testing facilities and examples of tests being performed. The host, who is Bill McKim, who was played by John Michael Higgins, told the guests that they would take part in some of these tests and also told the technician, Sherry, what test to set up. Small videos of each test were shown as he spoke. He finally told her to choose one final surprise test, and a video of a car crashing into a barrier was shown as a door opened for guests to enter the interior queue. So we'll now move on to the ride layout for the original test track. Upon reaching the end of the second queue, guests were loaded into test cars. Upon dispatching from the loading dock, the car was brought through an accelerated hill climb. Next, the car suspension was tested over different types of road surfaces, including German and Belgian blocks and cobblestones. Next, the car's anti-lock braking system was turned off, and the car tried to navigate a course of cones, knocking many over in the process. The anti-lock brakes were then turned back on, and a similar cone course was navigated easily. Guests were then shown a video overlay of the difference. Then the cars were brought through three environmental chambers: the heat chamber, featuring 192 heat lamps, the cold chamber, and the corrosion chamber, which featured robots on both sides that spray yellow mist. The handling of the car was then tested. It climbed a set of hills with blind turns while increasing its speed by 10% each time. At the top, the car almost crashes into an oncoming semi-truck before swerving out of the way. The car was now brought to the final test shown in the briefing room, the barrier test. The car lined up across from a barrier and began to accelerate towards it. Just before hitting the barrier, a series of flashes occurred where a picture of the guests were taken, and the barrier opened to a track outside. The car traveled along a straightaway into a boot-shaped turnover over an employee parking lot, then took a lap around the building with bank turns and a max speed of 64.9 miles per hour. That's 104.6 kilometers per hour. As the car returned to the loading dock, a thermal scan was taken of the guests and shown on a large screen. Like many Disney attractions, Test Track exited into a themed gift shop featuring merchandise associated with the attraction. Guests could also view and purchase photos taken of their vehicle on the ride or scan their photo pass to view or purchase the photos later. There was also an area where there was a showroom of the all-new prototype or legendary GM vehicles. Let's now talk about the original post-show for Test Track 1.0. Experience designer Bob Rogers and the design team, BRC Imagination Arts, were commissioned to create the new post-show experience called the Assembly Experience. The Assembly Experience is a walkthrough environment giving guests the illusion that they are on the floor of a vast automotive assembly plant. Automotive doors, seats, and engines glide overhead on assembly line chain veers, while simulated automotive die press caused the floor to rumble as each automotive part was pressed. Video monitors provided real GM workers a chance to tell Epcot visitors how they felt about their products and their work. Some time had passed and Test Track 1.0 got an upgrade to be known as Test Track 2.0, which was presented by Chevrolet. On January 6, 2012, Disney Parks announced plans to renovate Test Track during the second and third quarters of the year and reopen the ride by fall of 2012. As part of the update, Test Track's sponsor became General Motors Chevrolet Marquis instead of GM as a whole. The new additions include a pre-show area where guests design a new car for testing in the Chevrolet Design Center. Then they board Test Track's existing six-passenger ride vehicles, to be known as Sim Cars, to see how their design fares on the center's driving course. The experience concludes in a renovated showroom featuring current and future Chevrolet products. The ride vehicles were repainted, and while the track was unchanged, the setting was overhauled. On April 27, 2012, Walt Disney's social media manager, Jennifer Fickley Baker, released a set of concept design photos. Within the photos, it was confirmed that the ride will have four main tests: capability, efficiency, responsiveness, and power. The ride closed on April 15, 2012, and soon later barriers were placed along all walkways leading to either the entrance or exit of the ride. Also, a musical show called Test Track All-Stars was added in front of the former main entrance to Test Track, which closed on December 4th, 2012. The refurbished attraction first opened to guests during a soft opening on December 3rd, 2012. The grand reopening took place on December 6, 2012. Test Track was then again closed on January 13, 2020 for a refurbishment. It then reopened a month later on February 26. And then on September 2nd, the attraction was shut down again due to technical issues. So let's talk about the queue for Test Track 2.0. The first queue uses the same area as the old, but it is themed to the Chevrolet Design Studio at Epcot. Designers passed by two concept cars, the Chevrolet Murray and the Chevrolet ENV. Afterwards, the standby queue leads to a section where a small model car is drawn on through projections, while one of Chevrolet's employees discusses the design process for cars. Then the standby queue goes by large touchscreens, where designers can take tutorials on how to design a car. Once at the front of the queue, designers use their magic band, park ticket, or receive a white RFID card called a design key and wait for a set of doors to open leading into one of the two design studios. Once in the studio, designers have a set amount of time to design their own Chevrolet custom concept vehicle that will be tested on the sim track based on the four performance attributes: capability, efficiency, responsiveness, or power. Once the time expires, designers move to the second queue, which leads to the loading area. For Lightning Lane designers, the queue goes directly to the main design studios. For single riders, guests use their Magic Band ticket or a design key to select a pre-designed vehicle from one of the four performance attributes. Once guests select their vehicle, they move to the same second queue. While waiting to board the sim cars, all designers must scan their Magic Band ticket or design key again at the gate to upload their Chevrolet custom concept vehicle to the sim car. So let's move on to the ride overview for Test Track 2.0. Once the gates open, designers board the sim cars and fasten their seatbelts. They will be checked and dispatched by a test track technician. Afterwards, designers will embark on an exciting journey through the digital testing environment on the sim track. Along the way, designers will find out how their design choices directly affect their Chevrolet custom concept vehicle's performance numbers by undergoing the four different tests based on the four attributes. In the capability test, the car first connects to OnStar while passing a snowflake on the left, which is composed of World of Motion logos, then accelerates past a rain projection and skids out of control. Next, the continuing path disappears and the sim car turns around to speed up again. A short time later, the sim car makes a sharp left turn as a lightning bolt strikes. The car then passes by Futuristic City, which is an unintentional reference to Center Core, an amazing city of the future from World of Motion. Following the capability test, the results of which car design scored the best in the test are displayed. The sim car then begins the efficiency test. In the first part, the sim's car are scanned for optimum eco-efficiency. The second test performs an aerodynamic test on the vehicle. Finally, hyperspectrum imaging takes place. On either sides of the walls, designers can spot a WED performance text inscribed on one of the tires in honor of WED, Walter Elias Disney's initials, and the original name of Walt Disney Imagineering, the division of the company that built theme parks. Again, after the test is complete, the best scores are displayed. The third test, responsiveness, is next. The sim car accelerates around hairpin turns with laser-projected trees. After the first turn, a sign on the left can be seen that says Motion Lane 82, General Motorway 99, Bowtie Boulevard 12, all of which reference the three attractions that have been in the building and their opening years. Afterwards, two more signs can be seen after a few more turns. One with the turn right to go left quote from the 2006 Pixar film Cars, and one with beaver X-ing, referencing a GM plant in Beaverton, Oregon, where Imagineers visited GM employees to help with the original test track. The sim car then enters a tunnel to encounter the 18-wheeler from the original version, though it is now shown with lasers. When the vehicle exits the tunnel, the results for the responsiveness test are displayed and all of the test icons are displayed. The final test is power, where the sim car stops for a moment. It then accelerates through flashing purple arches towards a wall with the ride's logo on it. The doors split open and the car exits the building. Designers can spot a sign with the number 82 referencing Epcot and World of Motion's opening year just before the drop. This is followed by another one with a futuristic city picture, which is a reference to World of Motion Center Core. The sim car accelerates along a straightaway until it crosses over Avenue of the Stars as guests get their pictures taken. Designers can spot another sign that pays tribute to World of Motion, this time with the logo and the FN2BFRE text, referencing to the former ride's theme song, It's Fun to Be Free, at which point the sim car makes a 90-degree right turn, then a 270-degree left turn circling over a cast member parking lot. Exiting the turn, the sim car then travels back down another straightaway before making a complete counterclockwise circle around the ride building. When the test is complete, the vehicle descends back to the loading station where the next group of designers board. So let's talk about the updated post-show for Test Track 2.0. Designers can use their Magic Band ticket or design key that has their Chevrolet custom concept vehicle that they made in the design studio to see their scores from the ride, play games, and make an ad in the Chevrolet showroom. In the showroom, designers can also check out some of the newest Chevrolet vehicles, take virtual photos with their custom designed cars, and make sim car cards with their cars using their Magic Band ticket or design key. There is also a gift shop located at the exit like the original version of the ride. Many World of Motion logos can be found throughout the attraction. These logos are references to the old attraction and can be found on trash bins, murals, the attraction's main sign, and signage that directs Epcot guests to the attraction. And here's a little bit of a bonus fact that I just found out while doing research for this attraction. On September 9th, 2023, Disney announced that Test Track would be receiving a third retheming inspired by the original World of Motion ride. Test Track 2.0 closed permanently on June 17th, 2024 to make way for the ride's third version, Test Track 3.0, while Chevrolet is still planned to be the attraction sponsor. And the opening for Test Track 3.0 is to be sometime in 2025. So if anybody out there who is a fan of Disney or at least a big fan of Test Track, if you guys know a soft opening day or the official opening day, please let me know because I just like to know. So my experience with Test Track, I only went on this ride one time. And that was the first time that I went to Disney World back in 2016 with my mom and my sister. We had a blast designing the car. We liked going through the whole testing thing, and I did keep the picture of us in the test car, and it is pretty funny, so I'm going to put it up right now. So in this picture, you can see my mom, my sister, and I. We are in the back, and my sister and I are laughing our butts off because my mom was freaking out the entire time, and it was just so funny. I mean, it was like going, oh my gosh, super fast, but like a regular roller coaster would go fast, but it was just a blast to go on to. So the only reason that I have been on Test Track one time is because when I went back to Disney World the second time in 2019 with my mom and my sister, I talked about this in another previous ride vehicle about Epcot. And I explained that when we went back the second time, we all agreed not to go to Epcot because we experienced it once. We didn't want to go again. Plus, we went in October, and during October at Epcot is the Food and Wine Festival. It is nuts. And then when I went a third time in 2021 on my honeymoon, that was when they got rid of Fast Pass and they invented the new Genie Plus system. And my husband and I didn't feel like waiting in that very long line, and we didn't want to pay to go get a fast pass through the Genie Plus system. No offense to people who decide to use the Genie Plus system to skip the ride times. And I said that back in 2021 when I did my vlog videos from my honeymoon. I did talk about, no offense to the people who like using the Genie Plus system, but my husband and I didn't want to pay, what was it, back 3 years ago now? It came out, it was like $30 per person per ride. We just didn't feel like paying that. So there you have it, all the facts to Test Track. If you like this video, please hit that like button and don't forget to subscribe, and I hope you have a zippity-doo-dah day. Goodbye.